This is from my roof. What I've built is a robot which tracks litter and collects it. So you can see that it's tracking a couple of things. And what I've used is tracking.js. It's a very neat library which uses OpenCV. So this is OpenCV, which we all know is an computer vision software. It's very ancient. I think it's been around since what, I don't know, 10 years maybe more. And this is a compressed, a more recent version of it, but it's all inside the web browser. Since WebRTC is all about doing it all inside your web browsers, so it was just pretty clear that I had to use that one. So what really I am doing is I'm building a robot, self-navigated, autonomous as much as possible. It doesn't use a centralized model of media streaming. It uses a peer-to-peer model, which is built on WebRTC. And in addition to that, instead of using an IoT framework like MQTT or something else, I'm just using WebRTC data channels to do that. And this is an old version. I hope this is going to be visible. Yeah. This was an old version, maybe version 3 or 4. Okay, 6.5, it's there. So this is the mechanism. It just uses a couple of brushes to pick up litter. Yeah. So here you can see it has a lot of motors. You can see the big bulky battery at the back and some design flows, the garbage all flying around. But it was pretty effective. I mean, it was able to collect about, 50% of what it gathered to the buses. Some of it obviously fell out. This is a real run on the road. So this is built for roads, not built for your indoor tile cleaning like Roombas are built and sucking, like vacuum cleaner sucking technologies are built. This is built for outdoors. And this was a very primitive navigation system I had made using a lot of combinations from GStreamer, FFmpeg, trying to get a stream online. It was sometimes HTTPS, sometimes I was using MJPEG. So because WebRTC was not really on Raspberry Pis around that time, this is compute model or something else. So a lot of challenges. But since then, we've come a long way. WebRTC is now in. So for the latest version that I have built, I have made it solar powered. And instead of using all the outdated video codec technologies, I've used WebRTC. And this is how it looks now. This is just a prototype version though. I'm still making it. So there is no battery except for small batteries, which I'm using just for the RPi, because I don't want to depend on solar for RPi. Other motors are completely dependent just on the solar panel. Now we know that solar panel, it doesn't generate as much energy as a lead acid battery would do. So I have to really efficiently utilize the energy that I'm generating through the solar panel. So why am I making all this? You know already. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to only switch on the front brushes when I'm detecting garbage. So if I'm continuously running it, there's going to be a bigger drain of power that need not be. I mean, brushes need not to be running when there's nothing. So I'm using WebRTC-based object detection to detect what all I have to pick and then only start the brushes at that time. So for example, in this one, I've detected something here, so it'll start the brush. Then here, it'll undetected objects, but it'll still start the brush. Something it detects, something it doesn't detect. So I'm still working on the models here. Everything is open source, by the way. It's on my GitHub repository for RamuDroid. And let's just touch upon WebRTC. I think a lot of people have already demonstrated it, and a lot of people are using it, and some are in disbelief whether WebRTC is actually working or not. Well, it is really working. It's really, really important. A lot of big players out there, you obviously recognize Facebook Messenger, Slack, Snapchat, WhatsApp. They're all using WebRTC. So it's all around you. And how did it all start? There were a couple of companies Google acquired. couple of codecs which were made royalty free to get embedded into the browser. Very, very supported by W3C IETF, who made the standards, and media drafted the RFCs for it. And now it's all out there for us to use. The various ways you can, you know, use WebRTC, there are all these client libraries. Some use very, very popular VoIP protocols like SIP, and some just use WebSockets or Socket.io. And again, the ones who use the VoIP path use the VoIP-specific servers. The ones who just go on their own path and try and make something different, like an IoT device or a exclusive messenger device, they just end up using Socket.io or some other PubNub protocol. So I'm missing Safari here and Internet Explorer also. So now it's pretty much supported on all popular operating devices, operating platforms. And yeah, I'm sure this is not really needed. Why WebRTC? It's all free. It's easy. Royalty free. I mean, what else do you need? It's very, very customizable. I mean, let me tell you that. All the components in WebRTC stack. So these are the low levels. These are the core APIs we are familiar with. One lets you collect the media devices. One lets you create a peer-to-peer channel. And one lets you do a data channel as well. I mean, it supports all kind of multimedia. You can do video streaming, audio streaming, data streaming. You can then on top of that, you can build screen share, you know, collaborative workspaces like the ones we saw a little earlier, augmented reality applications, I mean, two-player gaming, multiplayer gaming, conferences, anything you like. And how WebRTC fits in other domains, like a lot of people are now using WebRTC-based streams to do surveillances. They're making their own, you know, pet monitor cams or baby cams or their security cams. Yeah, robotics. This is what I just showed is a very, very small instance of where I'm using WebRTC streams in robot and how robot can use the WebRTC stream to track objects and take action. But you could also use it in smart cities, a car, connected vehicles, wearables, etc. Telecom. So yeah, this, I'm not sure if I really have time. I think I have some. So I just wanted to touch upon this, that WebRTC has like got very deeply integrated into VoIP and telecom spaces. Now I think all the calls that we get from the credit card companies or, you know, personal loans, they also have a WebRTC agent more or less on the other side. I mean, we are the PSTN agents, but they have a WebRTC agent. They make the call through that, then it gets transported into other codecs and gets to recording server. There's a whole network of server components, but somewhere in one of those components is a WebRTC server and a WebRTC client. So, it is just everywhere and all telecom operators you can think of. So that's about it. And I'm open for questions now. Pradeep?
So, thanks a lot, Altnai, for this wonderful presentation and the demo. So the question I have specifically about Ramudroid is where are we at this project? What is the stage of this project or what is the impact that you have seen?
I think I just made it when there was a good hype about Bharat Swachhata and Swachhata Abhiyan. I just thought of, you know, automating the whole job from companies. We were doing these CSR activities where we were going and picking up litter from the roads. And I just thought, oh, it can be automated. So start from there. I think I've developed it a little slowly, but because it's an open source project and it's completely funded by me and a couple of other developers. There's my friend Sanjay Vipin, and other friends, Pankaj Kumar, and some of the older colleagues and other people I just come across in events who give good feedback and volunteer to you know, do a little bit of maybe mechanical design improvements or electrical improvements. Where I'm going with this, I just want it to be used. I think I did talk to some people that I could take it to get some government funding, because after all, it cannot be commercialized, because it's not for indoor cleaning, it's for outdoor cleaning. So I think if at all, there could be some good funding, could be from government. Otherwise, I'll just keep on building it. I think overall, I just want to make it in good spirit.
Got it. So can you talk more about what were the components that you use? What were the technologies that you used in building RamuDroid? And what specifically was challenging?
Absolutely. So let me take you back to this one slide. This one. So you could see from this image, there's a big solar panel. This is going to generate enough power. This is 60 watt solar panel. I could not get a lighter version. This is about 5 kg, which is huge for such a small device, but it's somehow sturdy enough to balance. And beneath this, there's a bin here. You could see this. It's big enough to collect enough trash. As it goes, it keeps collecting. And when it's full, it goes back to its base station and discards the trash and comes back to pick up more from where it had left. There are some brushes in the front, like this. These brushes, I'm improving the design of these brushes. These brushes go clockwise and anti-clockwise. The garbage really goes beneath the brushes and gets collected on the tray. And then there's Arduino to synchronize the movement of the front and rear motors for the wheels and the front brushes. There's Raspberry Pi, which is like the heart of the whole system. It communicates with the external world. It also controls every other aspect of the robot, from camera streaming to other sensors. And it also lets a remote person navigate or override the control if required. For major part, the web streaming is on WebRTC. So this is just the tracking, but I'm also, I can show you in one of the other slides. Yeah, so this one, you could see I'm doing a little bit of augmented reality to map the directions, just so that it can calibrate whether it's going in the right direction or how far does it have to go. This, the remote agent who's maybe monitoring the progress of the robot can gauge how far it has gone and if it's tilted by any chance, or if it's getting disbalanced or something like that. The challenges, I think, are meeting the Indian roads expectations, because there's just a lot of ups and downs in Indian roads, potholes and wet mud and whatnot. So the design has to be sturdy enough to withstand all that wear and tear. So I'm working on that. Pradeep?
Got it. Awesome. So, and technology-wise, what was the challenging in engineering part, apart from the design? What was the challenging part?
Challenging part is the, of course, the classifiers to detect an object. I think it's very important these days that we be able to detect recyclable waste from non-recyclable waste. It's a very challenging area where a lot of people are working. There's still... there's BBMP in Bangalore who's responsible for collecting waste, and then they segregate it manually. It's just a waste of everybody's time when it can be automated if you really think about it. But it's not a domain where people like to focus their energies into. So no serious effort really is going into that direction. But I would say waste segregation is a very challenging field, which I'm trying to achieve, maybe because I'm doing object tracking, I can actually keep a track of how much recyclable and non-recyclable waste the garbage, the robot has collected today. So this is very challenging, actually. Yeah.
Got it. Makes sense. So this, I find it really useful, because every morning I have to tell someone who cleans that, you need to clean this and you need to clean that. If it can be done by robot automatically, that helps a lot of problem at personal level. And as you said, it solves a big, big, huge problem that we have in public area.
Yes.
So, and apart from that, this is something which if machine can do, I think humans should let machine do. We can focus on other things. So that was really, really interesting project that you had there. And a couple of more things which I can think of right now is if you can talk about, you said you are in WebRTC and you are using WebRTC a lot. Very key, it was a key part of in this project. Can you tell as a developer, because audience we have are the developers, and how do they go about learning more about WebRTC? Where to start, and anything, any learning that you have learned that you would want to give someone who is just getting started with WebRTC?
Well, I would say if you are getting started with WebRTC now, you're already very, very late. So you should do it really quickly, because I think folks have been starting using WebRTC in their college projects itself. So if you are already a passed out and with maybe like 1 or 2 years experience, you should already have WebRTC in your skill set. Where you could start, there are like, numerous repositories and numerous tutorials, books. You could also read mine. I mean, I have a lot of open source repositories, demos. You could start maybe by using WebRTC for a peer-to-peer VoIP or a call-based scenario, and then you can think of more use cases to build on top, like the one with interactive TV thing, the one before me, that was very interesting. The one even before me, that was also fun. They could just start, the Google itself has a very good explanation of all WebRTC components, and I would personally recommend you to start with Mozilla, because I find Mozilla a little more MDN repositories to be a little more descriptive, and I've been relying on that. There are other blogs like WebRTC hacks, and there's a lot of repos. Like I showed you the stacks, JSTIP, SIPML5, Simple WebRTC, there's so many of them. And they all have a quick start guide. You could just get an NPM setup build, install all the related modules, and then do NPM start, and just start on your browser. And there are other debugging tools like Chrome WebRTC internals. You could just monitor the traffic.
Awesome. Perfect. So yesterday we had talked with Harshita about Raspberry Pi. And today we have connected that with WebRTC. And also we talked about computer vision from Byron and from you. I think this covers a whole lot of area in multiple fields. And that's really useful learning for everyone. And we have one question coming in. Let me just, from Akhil. Just put him here. Yes, Akhil.
Hey, hi, Altanay. Altanay, right? Hi.
Hi. I can't hear you.
Hi, Altanay.
Hi.
Can you hear now?
Yeah. Yes.
So it's a great project, and 5 years into that, it's a great contribution also. And I have two questions. First question is, how are you actually detecting those objects as paper or recyclable things? Right. And recyclable?
So,
and a second question, how can I buy your book you have showed in your starting of the presentation?
Okay, I can. So, how am I doing it? So I've received some XML models ready-made very kindly by some of the people who came across my project. So far, there are a few projects which are already there on the OpenCV examples. There is a bottle classifier which detects bottles. There are classifiers for leaves, but leaves come in all shapes and sizes, so it requires a lot of training. There are other, if you open OpenCV example repository, there are pedestrian detections, lower body detection, person detection, and I think paper.xml was contributed by one person. I can probably paste a link to his GitHub repository if I find it in time. And where can you buy my book? It's there on Google Books and Amazon.in and Amazon.com. So, and my publishers are PACT, so you can even buy from PACT website.
Thanks for the answer.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Akhil, for the questions. Thank Altanai for wonderful session and your